Part eight.
And we've been looking at this thing from the Gospel of John and the signs that he recorded, and that John had chosen those signs bringing or describing the divine life. And we looked at the first sign, the water into wine, and the second one, the nobleman's son, and the third one, the lame man at the pool of Bethesda. And then last Wednesday, we looked at the feeding of the 5,000 and how that was the beginning of the controversy of Jesus when he was at the peak of his ministry, when they wanted to make him king. And I don't know, I still, my mind kind of goes back there, and I've just thought about it, how that, those blessings ended up separating those people. That's amazing, because of the blessings, and I mean, it just, to me, it just, it brings it down to the point, and I don't know, I was thinking of Rizpah. Y'all remember Rizpah? Rizpah, her son was taken and put on a pole, killed, and hung there, and she went and sat on that rock and mourned all that time. And in my mind, to me, she's like Mary coming to the tomb. I mean, that to me, that's who, and I mean, I see all these, all kinds of blessings, if you will, in lots of different things. And Lord knows we've all had those. The Lord has blessed us with all kinds of things, but it comes right down to the point where none of that will do. Gotta have Him. Gotta have Him. And those blessings right there, with that great separation, and we're gonna go to the next miracle. But I'm gonna read you this verse here. We've went over every time, but here it is in John 20, 30, and 31. And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written, and I mean, just think about this. These were recorded for a purpose, that ye might believe that Jesus is the Christ. These were the ones that John selected, that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. Many other signs, so many, the scripture says that they all couldn't be recorded, but John chose these, that he might lead these disciples into faith. That's the word believe right there, faith, through which they would receive life. And when I say faith now we know that we quickly want to get rid of our faith, come into Jesus' faith, but what? And I don't want to go down this trail here, but I still remember a couple Sundays ago, just I get so aggravated when I hear people belittle faith. And faith is the word that we use when we got nothing else. You know, well, I don't know what I'm going to do. I remember this song by Eric Clapton. It used to be one of my favorites. It's called "I've Been Running on Faith." Lately, I've been running on faith. Yeah. In other words, you know, I don't know what else to do. Faith's all I got. Don't know where I'm going. That's not the faith. Yeah. That's ignorance, is what that is. That's really ignorance. And when I say that's ignorance, that's why Paul would say that I might know Him. We don't want to go ignorant into this thing. I mean, to me, and I understand, I mean, when people say, you know, they'll talk about a little child. Have you ever heard of like a little child, you put them on a counter, tell them to jump off in mommy's arms, and they will. And people say, that's the kind of faith you got to have. But they missed the whole key of that. That's a mommy-daughter relationship has already been established, because you tell little Susie right there to jump off in a stranger's arms, are they going to do it? Probably not. So there, you know what I mean? There has to be some relationship established there, some knowing, some trust, before you're going to do that. And this is what he is doing here. He's not trying to get you ignorant that you might know him. John selected these out, that through this faith, this substance, you may have life. And Paul would say that I may know him. That I may know him. Well, this fifth sign comes right after the feeding of the 5,000 right here in John 6. And it starts in verse 16. I'll go ahead and read it. It's pretty short. In verse 16, John 6 and 16, when even was now come, his disciples went down into the sea and entered into a ship and went over the sea towards Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus was not come to them. And the sea arose by reason of a great wind that blew. So when they had rowed about 25 or 30 furlongs, they see Jesus walking on the sea. Drawing nigh unto the ship, they were afraid. But he saith unto them, it is I, be not afraid. Then they willingly received him into the ship. And immediately the ship was at the land whither they went. Now, this sign right here is not long, and it doesn't contain all the details that the other Gospels portray. And it's pretty short, but this must be important, or John wouldn't have included it. And I want you to notice something here. The multitudes had gone away. They were gone. So he's going to deal with his disciples alone. And this is important to their, I'm going to use this word, training, if you will. Because there is a training. There is a training. I mean, you know, you just like there's a growing up, there's a training. There is this training. But when Matthew and I think Mark record, they use other details. John doesn't, because John has just one object. He's reducing the whole thing down to just one purpose. Because remember, that's why we read that you might have life. So he's throwing all the other stuff out. But there's a word here, and I want to go over here to Matthew and Mark and look at those here just a quick second. There's a word here that I want to get at that just kind of got my wheels to turning. Let's go to Matthew 14 real quick. Matthew 14 and 23. This is again right after he's fed the 5,000, and straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship to go before him into the other side while he sent the multitudes away. And then Mark 6:45. And straightway he constrained his disciples to get into the ship and to go to the other side. It's the word constrained. And it means to make necessary. Jesus made it necessary for them to get into the boat. Now that's a strong word. You remember when Jesus is in the multitude and the woman with the issue of blood comes up and touches the hem of his garment? And he says, "Who touched me?" And the disciples are like, "My gosh, how can you tell who touched you? I mean, look at that." The scripture says that the multitudes, what they thronged him. And that's the same word, thronged. What that, in that sense, that would be like, the whole crowd is going this way and you're trying to go this way. And you just can't get it going. And when they led Jesus, they bound him in the Garden of Gethsemane and they led him before Caiaphas. And the men, it says, they held him, the same word, they constrained him. In other words, there was no need for Jesus trying to get away. He was constrained. And what I'm saying here is Jesus wasn't requesting or asking them to get into the boat. He was making it necessary for them to get into the boat and to go to the other side. I think that's kind of strange. Because Jesus knew, remember when he fed the 5,000, he says it this way. I'm back over in John 6. In John 6:6, this he said to prove him, for he himself knew what he would do. Jesus knew what he was going to do when he constrained them to get into the boat. And it was a deliberate part. And he separated the multitudes. It's dark. Jesus, I mean, when I just look at this, it was now dark, and Jesus was not come to them. And he tells them to get into the boat. He was putting them into situations that would make it necessary for them to make a new discovery of him. Now let me say that again. He was putting them into situations that would make it necessary for them to make a new discovery of him. Now that kind of blows my mind.
He was setting them up.
Yeah, so they could learn of him.
Yeah. He does the same thing today with us, don't you think?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And I think that's, of course, we're going to get to some scriptures right here, but See, he did that with the feeding of the 5,000. He did that with the water and the wine. He did that with the man at the pool of Bethesda. So they can learn something of him each time. See, the storm was no surprise to Jesus. Now, I'm not saying at all that he caused the storm. We're going to look at that. He didn't cause the storm. But here, let me give you a scripture here. And now think that he put them into situations that would make it necessary for them to discover something new of him. Now, I'm in 1 Peter chapter 4. Beloved, I'm in verse 12. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. But rejoice, inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's suffering, that when his glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. Let me back up to chapter 1, verse 7. That the trial of your faith, being more precious than of gold that perisheth, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto the praise and honor and glory at the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now remember this setting here? Jesus had not yet come to them. I just think about all the situations that we get into. I'm not saying the Lord causes these situations. Most of the times we cause the situations. But in each one of those situations, we're always wanting a way out instead of it being another opportunity for us to learn something new of Him that we have never seen before. Now, that's a hard thing. I mean, Peter then would say, why do you think it a strange thing that this trial is more precious than gold? And you got to understand that everything in the life of a believer is about Christ and the increase of Christ in his body. So there is not one moment that he's not using to get us to turn our hearts more to see him. In those situations, I wonder how much do we really pay attention to every move that is going on. Really kind of blows my mind. Let's go back over here to this story here. Now remember, here, this is a sign, not a miracle. And you know, this sign, it has a deeper meaning. Now, where is Jesus? Well, the scripture says that he went into a mountain himself alone. Now, if you read the other text, you'll see that he went up into the mountain to pray. So the first thing we see right here is Jesus making intercession. He's in Mount Zion in the high places. Jesus, first thing we see is Jesus exalted to the right hand of the Father, to the right hand of the Majesty on high. The scripture says he is ascended on high and led captivity captive. What's he doing up there? He ever liveth to make intercession for the saints. All this is in this sign right here. Jesus is he's given a little prophetic view here to all power in heaven and earth being given unto him. And we have the sea here, and I think everybody knows what the sea is. The sea is the nations, the peoples. Remember what he told Peter? Follow me and I'll make you fishers of men. The day of Pentecost, he let down his net and caught 3,000 great fishes. But you can see how restless the nations are. They're always changing, never be sure of them. Sometimes there's storms, sometimes there's calms. The only thing you can be sure of is always uncertain. Always. I see when the disciples set out, it was calm. I'm sure when they got into the boat, Jesus constrained them to get into the boat. There wasn't no storm. It's pretty easy for them to get into the boat and think this is going to be an easy ride. We'll meet you on the other side. But how quickly it changed. Paul's journey started that way. They started out very calm, and you know how that story ended up. How restless the nations, how uncertain all the situations in the world are. But here's the thing, Jesus deliberately sent them into that. I mean, it reminds me of the scripture here in John 17. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which thou hast given me, for they are mine. Verse 15, I pray not that thou should take them out of the world, but that thou should keep them from the evil. So what about the storm? The scripture says the sea arose by reason of a great wind. And I don't know if people understand all this or not, but you know, Jesus divided the light from the darkness. The kingdom delivered us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. But yet we still live in this world, in the world of darkness. Our bodies, our lives still function in this world that is run by corrupt governments, everything. And I mean, you know as well as I do, I mean, it's evil and corrupt, yet here we are. And in this world, Paul would say, the God of this world has blinded their eyes or blinded their minds. So there is a God of this world, a God of this darkness, and there, I know this is hard because I hate to even go there, but really, there's like evil forces and stuff at work in this world of darkness. And that's why the seas up and down and unstable and all that. Now, we have been delivered from that, but yet sit right back down into that. See, that kind of blows my mind sometimes. But you know, and I know you guys are all well read, but I just want you to think of the things that the Apostle Paul dealt with and the people that he had to deal with I think about the little girl that the guy used, and he cast the devil out of her or whatever and ruined his business, and you know, things like that. So it was always, there's no battle over here. Right? But over here, there is. Now over here we rest, but here we don't. And that's hard for the mind to get around, okay? Because it's like our soul is here in this place of rest. And see, we can do these things over here out from a place of rest. All right? I don't know if I'm making any sense or not, but I mean, Paul, you know, against principalities and powers, spiritual wickedness and, you know, all of those things, they're all here. They're not here. Only thing over here that you can bring in would be your imagination. They can't get by the cross. Right? But over here. So, he sends them into this. And, you know, I mentioned this a few weeks ago, that there was a great move of God, a great revealing, if you will. But with that comes a great resistance. And, I mean, it always does. And the more the revelation, the more the resistance. I mean, you'll find that one in your own heart, but you'll also find it too out in the world. And, you know, I've heard people say this, and I, you know, I know this. There's a lot more things that I don't know than what I do know. But I can tell you this. When I'm up here playing music on Sunday, and my guitar gets out of tune, I don't blame that on the devil. You know what I mean? There's some people say, well, the devil's trying to get in my praise and get my guitar out of tune. Well, I don't believe that. But I think there are times when he can really lay some stumbling hindrances all around you into some major situations. And I think the Lord had sent them right in. The Lord knew what was coming. He deliberately sent them knowing. Do you think he said, oh my God, a storm arose? He knew a storm was coming. Sent them right into it. Now, this strong wind, it's blowing, it's contrary. It's very hard to row against. It's very hard to work against. And you know, in my mind, guys, you know what I'm thinking? I'm thinking, in one hand, of just even Christian people. Because, you know, guys, I was sick Sunday. Well, anyway, y'all bought that, didn't you?
Yeah, we bought it.
That is a, Denise is really going, what? But, you know, if this would have been 2 years ago, I had 20 preachers I could have called. But not now. Because I don't want nobody standing here that's going to preach anything other than Christ. And I don't know anybody. I mean, and that's terrible to say, but really, but when you really try to deal with somebody and say, listen, when you get up here and you're going to try to preach, you don't need to talk about the people. We need to talk about the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And I don't mean nowhere else. And so I see the contrariness that just rises up even amongst Christian people. And then in the world, I'm telling you what, I've been around talking with people, and before long, the conversation may lean towards religion, you know what I mean? And before long, you've cleared the room.
Yeah.
Because people don't want to talk about it. You know, they'll talk about Obamacare, Social Security, and the election. Start talking about Jesus. You got time for this. Argue with you all day over Donald Trump's campaign, but you know, it's contrary. But Jesus told them it would be like that. He said, in this world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I've overcome the world. I think a lot of people, and this is really it's really false doctrine, guys. It's really false doctrine to take somebody and say, man, the reason you're in trouble in your life right now is because you don't have Jesus in your life. Now, if you get Jesus in your life, all your troubles will go away. That's false. That is a lie. That is a lie. But what I'm saying is you can learn to rest in the storm. There's a big difference. Storm's still going right on. And you know as well as I do, some of the storms He has delivered me from, and not one drop of rain has hit me. And some of them I've had to plow right through.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you just never know which ones He's going to deliver you from and which ones you're going to have to go right through. But He said, I'll never leave you. I'll never forsake you. In this story, where is Jesus? Jesus is on the mountain. They are in the storm. He knows all about the situation. He constrained them to go, constrained them to get into the boat. How does He know about the situation? I mean, for us, because there is no separation. Christ is in you. He knows. Now, here's the natural thing. The natural thing was they would be overpowered by the sea and drowned in their boat, forced under. But remember, He has all power. So He's trying to teach these disciples that He has all power. And I don't know if I said this on a Wednesday or a Sunday, but we were talking about willpower and how we try to serve the Lord with our willpower, like we try to diet with our willpower. And people are going to, every year, we call them New Year's resolutions, and they're all based on willpower. And they, you know, some people could go farther because they got strong willpower, but nevertheless, but here's something I want you to think about. Our own nature. When I say our own nature, what I'm saying, I know that we're dead, we've been crucified with Christ, but our own imaginations, our own makeup, our own history, our own egos, our own, all of those things are too strong for us. They always are. They always are. And it's so easy for us to be drowned in our own makeup. You know what I'm talking about. That's just the way I am, people would say. Just the way I am. I like to change, but you know, I've been this way my whole life. And then, of course, you bring that up into the world or religion, and you know, religion is always trying to bring you under. And here's the thing, we're not under yet. You ever think about that? We're not under yet, right in the midst of the storms. You ever wonder why? Is it because you got strong willpower? Is it because you're a good prayer? Because you're a good, it's because He is in me. Greater is He that is in me than He's in the world, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, saith the Lord. And I was just thinking about that. We're not under. I mean, here we are, and I'm telling you what, just from my own take, when the Lord began to reveal His Son in me, and I seen what a
a great revelation it was, so excited, run back to tell everybody and get kicked out. I wonder what I'm going to do. It's a pretty stormy time. You wonder if it's all an imagination. Did you really show me? I mean, what is going on? Why would you make me get in this stinking boat and go this way? I thought everybody would say Jim Moore had the greatest revelation in the whole world and all needs to come hear him. I didn't think it was going to be, we don't preach that junk around here. Yeah. And it comes at the time, I don't know, you guys went through it. You come to a place where we can't go that way anymore. We got to go this way, and then it's all different. We don't know where we're going, but you know what? We're not sunk yet. I mean, I just think even the little things up here, you know, paying these bills and stuff, and no more people than what we've had, and just everything. And, you know, we get overwhelmed thinking about all these other little things that coming and going, but still yet, here's something I want you to think about. Who made them get in the boat? Jesus constrained them to get in the boat, so he's responsible for what happens to them while they're in that boat, isn't it? He's responsible for what happens. He's responsible for their safety while they're in that storm, isn't it? Because he told them to get in the boat. Now, he didn't ask them. You see what I'm telling you. If he said, Patty, get in this boat, and you get in this boat, and I want you to go to the other side, and during that time, you come up on a mess, who's responsible? He is, because he's the one that told you to go to the other side. And see, when I began to see that, I'm thinking, my gosh, you see where we are? Now, who is responsible? Now, maybe we can come back and kind of rest a little bit and think, who told us to go this way? He constrains us to get into the boat. Now listen to this. Our spiritual education rests upon this word necessity. And that's the real word for constraint. He made it necessary for the disciples to get into that boat. It is necessary for us to have experiences like this because it is only by such experience that we discover what a Christ we have. It's only by those experiences that we discover what a Christ we have. Now let me just close out with a couple scriptures here from Hebrews. Hebrews 12. I've heard these scriptures quoted to me so much. I'm just going to start reading here in 12:1. Wherefore, seeing also we are compassed about. Well, now, remember what's taking place right here. I mean, we're coming from one faith to another faith, from an old covenant faith to a new covenant faith. Remember, he's telling them to get into the boat and go to the other side, coming from one to the other, and it's dark when the journey begins, and Jesus is up on the mountain praying, and they're going through the storm. But there comes about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and sin which so doeth so easily beset us. Run with patience the race set before us. When I see this, guys, in my mind, I know this wasn't in John's depiction here, but I see Peter. And I see Peter say, Lord, if that's you, bid me come to you. Peter gets out of the boat and starts walking to him. But what beset Peter? Remember, right here, the Hebrew writer's telling us, let us lay aside the things which are going to draw us under. And what was it that drew him under? We could say, well, it was the boisterous waves. No, it wasn't the boisterous waves. He was walking on the boisterous waves. What made him go under was taking his eyes off of Jesus. Can you see now when it says, let us lay aside? We want to bring this around to actions. Well, can't drink no more, can't cuss no more, can't go here no more, can't, you know. wear pants anymore or whatever. It ain't about actions. Let us lay aside. Looking, and then he tells us, looking unto Jesus, the author, finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. I told you Jesus was in the mountain, Mount Zion. Then he says, for consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. He's talking about you're right into this. You're right into the storm. And it can make you weary, make you faint. But he's reminded them, don't you know, that you're not alone. You're compassed about with a great cloud of witnesses. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. In other words, what he's saying is to you guys, he said, look, these other guys over here, Isaiah and all of them, they resisted unto blood. In other words, they were sawn apart, beheaded. He's telling them, guys, you haven't come to that point yet. Nobody's beating you. It hasn't come to blood yet. And ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children, my son, despise not the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. Now these are the scriptures that was always given to me. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If ye endure chastening, God dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the Father chastens not? And guys, I always looked at this. Let me tell you where the reference would always come. The reference would always be to lower God down, lowering down to our natural dads. And say, God is like my natural dad because when I do wrong, he takes the belt and beats the dog out of me. And that's what these verses are saying. It would always be, you know, that when God's taking the rod and he's beating you to a pulp and he's going to teach you a lesson. That is not what he's saying here. There is training. And there is discipline. Because there's a whole lot of ways to discipline somebody than to beat them to a pulp. And I won't tarry too long on it, but I want to get to a point. He is training. He is disciplining. He is correcting. He's always doing those things in his people, in his body. He always is. There's a purpose in it. Now listen, I'm going to skip into verse 11. Now, no chastening for the present seemeth to be joyous. No storms that we're going through are going to seem like yippee-yay, but grievous. Nevertheless, after it yieldeth the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down, and feeble knees, make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way, but let it rather be healed. And I'm going to stop on that right there. But that's the last verse I'm going to read. Let me say this. In the old, and Patty, you and I, we talked about this the other day when I was telling you about Stephen. What we always done in the old was turn the lame out of the way. And you know, we go back to the qualifications of the priesthood, and whenever there was a blemish, we get them out. And the church has brought that up to today. And whenever there's a blemish, what do with them? We kick them out. We ask them not to come back. We don't want this in our church. We don't like this. But what does the writer say? But let it rather be healed. And I thought, my God, how, you know, in my mind, I'm thinking, well, how do we heal it? How do we heal it? How do we heal it? And I thought, oh, Lord, what did Peter say? Right there's our healing. Because to heal something means, well, wounded means there's a separation, right? There's a wound. Whatever it might be, there's a separation. So to heal it would mean to bring it back to one. And what way other than to, and I began to see something with his stripes were healed, and I'm thinking I'm looking for this and this and this, but he is our healing. You want to bring, but let it rather be healed, show them the healing, show them the one, show them him, show them the wholeness, but let it rather be healed. That's the only way the lame, because we already talked about the lame could do nothing but stay lame. He could not move from his place. He tried to move. But here in this life that Jesus is bringing his disciples to, we're seeing the lame be healed. We're seeing all these things, instead of being cast out, are made one. And I thought, oh my goodness. What you said was so true. They eat at our table. And we are to be a covering, yeah. Not to cast the lame to the side. And this only comes through this training, this discipline, if you will. So don't despise these things, but endure it. And he said it brings the peaceable fruit of righteousness. I thought, my goodness, wouldn't it? Isn't it going to be that we are going to come right face to face with every one of these situations are going to be put right to us? And now what are you going to do with them? Are you going to cast the lame out? Or, I mean, because I know, I just know where I would have been 5 years ago. Because I knew what the righteousness of the church was supposed to be, because I had the guidelines to go by. Until I began to see him. And that changes the whole thing. So, all right, I'll quit back.